Welcome to the Indu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. These are the news articles chosen for today's discussion. They are given along with the page number of different editions. Link for the handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping for the discussed articles are given in the description box as well as the comment section for the benefit of the mobile viewers. Now let us start with the first article. Now let us take up this op-ed article for discussion. See, police force is the prime law enforcing agency in India. But our police force is suffering from many issues. And it requires a lot of reforms. For example, take the issue of human rights violation and custodial torture in police force. This issue has been plaguing of police force for many decades. Even our Chief Justice of India recently issued a statement regarding this human rights violation and custodial torture in police force. What was the statement? The threat to human rights and bodily integrity is the highest in police stations. This was a statement given by our Chief Justice of India. So, in this context, this editorial has been written. It highlights the serious issue of human rights violation and custodial torture in our police force. This editorial also discusses about the police reforms needed. The author of this editorial also gives some case laws and reports to support his points. So, very important article from main exam topic. So, pay attention. You can get a lot of value addition material from this discussion. Now let us move into the article discussion. The relevant syllabus is displayed on the screen. Interested aspirants can go through it. See, custodial torture is one of the gravest means of human rights violation. According to National Crime Records Bureau, NCRB, on average of about 100 custodial deaths have taken place every year between 2010 and 2019. This is the yearly average. 100 custodial deaths. See, for every custodial death, judicial inquiry is mandatory, but it was conducted for only 26.4 cases. Again, this is an average. Out of the 100 yearly average, only 26.4 cases were conducted judicial inquiry. So this statistic shows the seriousness of the issue. Now we have a question. What can we do to bring down the custodial violence? How can we reduce the custodial deaths and human rights violation in our police force? Very important topic, police reforms. Now let us discuss the important suggestions given by the author of the editorial. The first suggestion, see, according to the author, we should minimize the number of arrests. See, arrest is only necessary when the accused might tamper with the evidence or may cause some public nuisance. Only in these cases, arrest is essential. Otherwise, until conviction, arrest must be minimized. Also, according to Special Action Forum versus Union of India 2018 case, the police officer shall furnish to the magistrate the reasons that necessitated the arrest. The purpose of these checks is to ensure that police do not abuse the power of arrest. The police force should use arrest as the last resort. This is the first suggestion given by the author. Minimize the number of arrests. Now moving on to the next suggestion. The next suggestion is separating investigation from law and order. Let me explain the difference. For example, a case is registered for theft. First, investigation is done into the merits of the case. Who is the thief? What kind of theft has been done? This is the investigation part of the case. Now coming to law and order. See, law and order deals with the maintenance of peace in a locality. You know, the riot control, those kind of stuffs. They are law and order. Currently, both these responsibilities are entrusted with the police force. They are responsible for investigation. They are also responsible for maintaining law and order. So this is adding burden to the police force. They are stressed. They are working overtime. So in order to make their job easier, police resort to custodial torture. They want a quick confession. So they torture the accused. This resorts to custodial torture. I hope aspirants can follow. Another important point is, due to the overburden, the quality of the investigation is also poor. They do not have the sufficient time, they do not have the sufficient resources. So obviously the quality of investigation is also poor. So this is why our author is suggesting to separate investigation from law and order. There must be separate force for investigation, there must be separate force for law and order. This will minimize the burden. See, this is not the first time this suggestion has been given. For example, take Malimath Committee Report 2003. Take Prakash Singh versus Union of India case 2006. These reports and cases also suggested separating law and order from investigation. These points are very important. You can use it as value addition in your mains answer. If you're from PubMed optional, you can use it as value addition in your optional paper also. To make note of it. Now moving on to the next suggestion. See, according to the author, we should increase the number of investigating officers. Right now, the number of investigating officers are very low. They're investigating many cases. So it leads to a lot of custodial deaths, custodial torture, and the quality of investigation is also poor. So the author is suggesting to increase the number of investigating officers. See, according to Malimath committee, an investigating officer should preferably investigate no more than 10 cases every year. Then only the quality of the investigation will be good. But right now, we are not following this number. We should aspire to achieve this number. An investigator should only investigate only 10 cases every year. He should not cross that limit. Then only the quality of investigation will be good. Now moving on to the next suggestion. According to the author, we should install more CCTVs in police stations. See, in Paramveer Singh versus Baljit Singh case 2020, the Supreme Court of India also has directed states to cover more area of each police station under CCTV cameras. This same suggestion is also given by the author, installing more CCTVs in police stations. Also, according to Supreme Court of India, an independent committee should study the footage and periodically publish reports of the observations in the footage. Why this process is needed? Because it will bring accountability. If a committee is studying the footage from the police station, then it will bring accountability. There will be less custodial torture. There will be less custodial deaths. So this is an important suggestion given by the author. Installing more CCTVs. Now moving on to the next suggestion. See, the next suggestion is regarding the sensitization of police. For example, the police should be sensitized to break the traditional gender stereotypes and notions. These kind of trainings must be given to the police force. This will help us to develop a more humane police force. They will connect with the public, they will connect with the issues of the public, and there will be less custodial tortures and human rights violation. Now moving on to the next suggestion. See, according to the author, we should employ scientific tools of interrogation and investigation in our police force. For example, lie detection test, narco test, and brain fingerprinting test. These kind of tests should be employed in our interrogation and investigation techniques. The Western countries are doing these techniques and it is showing results. So we should also try to implement such scientific tools. These tools will reduce the human rights violation and custodial torture in our police station. So these are the suggestions told by the author to bring down the incidence of custodial torture. See, the points discussed in this editorial are very important. You can use the cases and statistics reports given in this editorial as value addition in your mains answer. For example, imagine a question like this. Custodial torture is a rampant method used in Indian police system illegally to expedite the judicial proceedings. Discuss. Suggest ways to mitigate the menace in the Indian police system. You can expect these kind of question in mains. For a question of this sort, this discussion will come handy. You can find relevant points in this discussion and you can also find the value addition material in this discussion. Very important article. Please make sure you make use of it. With this, we have come to the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about the human rights violation and custodial torture in our police force. We also discussed about the ways by which we can bring down the custodial violence. What are the ways? Minimize the number of arrests. Separating investigating from law and order. Improve the quality of investigation. Increase the number of investigating officers. Installing more CCTVs. Sensitization of police. And employing scientific tools of interrogation and investigation. These are the suggestions given by the author in this editorial. Now let us move on to the next discussion. Now let us take up this article. See, recently 2020 Summer Paralympic Games was held in Tokyo. It is still going on. So far, three players from India have won two silver and a bronze medal. Bhavina Patel, who is a table tennis star, and high jumper named Nishad Kumar won silver medal. When we are talking about bronze medal, it was won by discus thrower Vinod Kumar. Now let us congratulate the winners. They have made the country proud. So in this context, let us learn about Paralympic Games. What is the history of Paralympic Games? What are the categories included? Let us learn about it. See, the Paralympics was developed by Sir Ludwig Guttmann. It is a German word. The pronunciation is Guttmann. Okay. See, Sir Ludwig Guttmann was a Jewish neurosurgeon who fled Nazi Germany to England. During the World War times, Nazis were persecuting the Jews in Europe. So in order to escape the persecution of Nazis, he fled to England. In England, he opened a spinal injury center. The name of the center is Stoke Manuel Hospital. See, this is the history behind the Paralympics. In 1948, he organized a sports competition for the British World War II veterans with spinal cord injuries. This event was organized in England. It was organized by Sir Ludwig Gutmann in Stoke Manuel Hospital. As I already said, he was treating spinal injuries. So in order to treat the British World War II veterans with spinal cord injuries, this competition was started. The name of the competition is Stoke Manuel Games. The purpose of this game was to assist large number of war veterans and civilians who had been injured during wartime. So it was for rehabilitation. This was the noble intention behind the origin of Paralympic Games. During World Wars, many people got disabled. So in order to rehabilitate them, this sports was started. Later, this rehabilitation sport evolved to recreational sport. And further, recreational sport evolved into competitive sport. So officially, the Stoke Manuel Games became the Paralympic Games. And the first Paralympic Games took place in Rome, Italy in 1960. Since then, they have taken place every 4 years. I hope aspirants can follow. See, similar to Olympic Games, the Paralympic Games are also split into Winter and Summer Games. Right now, Summer Paralympic Games are going in Tokyo. See, the Summer and Winter Paralympic Games occur every 2 years alternatively. So in 2020, Summer Paralympic Games will take place. In 2022, Winter Paralympic Games will take place. In 2024, again Summer Paralympic Games will take place. Similar to normal Olympics. To put it in simple words, Summer Games and Winter Games occur 4 years once, but it occurs alternatively every 2 years. Now let us discuss about the governing body behind the Paralympic Games. The International Paralympic Committee is the global governing body of Paralympic movement. This committee was founded in 1989. It is the global governing body of Paralympic movement. Now coming to the host. See, the Paralympics are usually held in the same city that hosts the corresponding Olympic Games. First, the normal Olympics takes place. Within a short span of time, Paralympics takes place. This is the usual convention. So the host is the same city of the corresponding Olympic Games. Now let us discuss about the classification behind Paralympic Games. See, Paralympic athletes compete in 6 different disability groups. Let us see about these groups. The first group is amputee. See, amputee is a person who has lost all or part of an arm and leg due to surgical removal. So this is the first category. The next category is cerebral palsy. It is a neurological disorder. The third category is visual impairment. The fourth category is spinal cord injuries. The fifth category is intellectual disabilities. And the sixth category is others. Athletes whose disability does not fit into one of the other categories. This is the sixth category. So a disabled athlete participates in any one of these categories. See, within each group, athletes are further divided into classes on the basis of type and extent of their disabilities. For example, take intellectual disability. The type and extent of the intellectual disability varies. So within this category, athletes are further divided into classes based on the type and extent of their disabilities. I hope aspirants can follow. Another important point is the physical status can change. For example, a disabled person can improve in future years. So that athlete can be reclassified at later competition. Another example will be the disability can get worse as the time moves on. So the athlete can be reclassified at later competition based on their physical status changes. So these are the important points regarding Paralympics. With this, we have come to the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about the 2020 Summer Paralympic Games. We saw about the medal winners from India. We discussed about the origin of Paralympic Games. We discussed about International Paralympic Committee. And we discussed about the host of Paralympic Games. And finally, we discussed about the categories of Paralympic Games. Now let us move on to the next discussion. Now look at this editorial. This editorial is regarding follow-ups. So let us learn what is follow-ups. Why it is an important part of journalism. Let us discuss about it. The syllabus relevant to this article is displayed on the screen. Interested aspirants can go through it. First, what is a follow-up? See, follow-up in the context of journalism refers to a new story that provides additional information on a previously published article. For example, take the Afghanistan issue. On Monday, you're getting information regarding the Afghanistan issue. You're reading an article regarding the Afghanistan issue. After Monday, some additional articles are published on Afghanistan issue. These articles are called as follow-ups. New story which provides additional information on a previously published article. They are also called as supplementary stories. I hope aspirants can follow. See, follow-ups are very important. This is because they give extra details. These extra details can be new facts. It can also be about later developments. It can also be about reaction of the issues. This is why follow-ups are essential part of journalism. See, we can't cover the entire story in one article, because one story on its own may not properly cover all aspects of an event or all aspects of a controversy. There could be untouched side issues or later events which will need reporting. This is the main reason why follow-ups are an intrinsic part of journalism. Follow-ups provide continuity. It satisfies curiosity. It adds balance to the issue. And it also covers the missed aspect of the controversy or issue. I hope aspirants can follow. This is why follow-ups are essential part of journalism. See, another important point is follow-up ensures accountability. See, accountability is an important part of governance. Only through follow-ups, we can ensure that the executive is delivering on their commitment or not. This is why follow-ups are essential for ensuring accountability. This is because only through follow-ups, we can get the specifics of the event or controversy. It informs public. Thereby, it ensures executive is delivering on their commitment or not. It is an important part of accountability. But recently, many medias are not publishing follow-ups of issues. This is because media wants to pursue trending news. Only through trending news, they can increase their viewership. They have become commercial. They do not want to cover about the past issues. They want to be a part of the news cycle. They want to cover the trending news. For example, take farmers' protest. See, when you go few months back, almost all medias were covering about farmers' protest. This is because farmers' protest was a trending news at that time. So every media was covering about the farmers' protest. But right now, only few medias are covering about farmers' protest. There is no follow-up on farmers' protest. The farmers are still protesting. There are still issues with the farm laws. But many medias are not showing interest. They want to cover only trending news. They want to cover about Afghanistan. They want to cover about Taliban. And they are ignoring the farmers' protest. This is why this editorial has been written. In recent days, many medias are not pursuing follow-up articles. They want to cover only trending news. So this can create problems. Without follow-ups, the controversy will be put away from the spotlight. People will stop showing interest on the issue. They will also be less informed on the issue. So this can affect accountability. So this is why this author has written this editorial. According to the author, only through follow-ups, we can keep the focus on accountability and all those in power accountable. To highlight this point, the author of the editorial has given a case study. See, this case study is very important. You can use this case study as value addition in your mains answer. This case study is regarding Boston Globe reporters. See, Boston Globe is a newspaper in United States of America. And this newspaper documented sexual abuse by Catholic priest. This is the case study. See, the reporters of this newspaper did a series of investigation and follow-ups regarding the sexual abuse by Catholic priest. They built a team. They built a database. And they documented how many priests were involved in this crime. Through follow-ups, they covered entire aspect of the issues. Who were involved in these crimes? Who were involved in the cover-up? So they covered all the aspects of the crime. This was possible only through follow-ups. This newspaper published a lot of follow-up stories and it brought the scandal to the limelight. So this case study is an important example to highlight the importance of follow-ups. Boston Globe reporters case study. They documented the sexual abuse by Catholic priest. See, the Boston Globe received Pulitzer Prize for its investigation on follow-up articles. Another important point is this case study was made into a movie. The name of the movie is Spotlight. this movie won Best Picture Award at the Academy Awards. That is, it won an Oscar for Best Picture. Interested aspirants can see this movie. It is a brilliant movie. This movie will highlight the importance of follow-ups. So, the author of the editorial, by citing this example, has shown the importance of follow-ups to bring crimes to public attention. So, this shows that follow-ups are the best journalistic tool. It provides additional information to the public. It also establishes accountability. So, these are the important points highlighted in this editorial. See, this article discussion is very important from Mains perspective. In Mains, you can expect a question regarding media reforms. How to reform the journalism in India. So you can use this article as value addition in your solution part of the Mains answer. In solution, you can write the importance of follow-up to ensure journalistic integrity. And you can also cite the Boston Globe case study to stress your point. This is why the editorial discussions are very important. They provide a lot of value additions to your Mains answer. So with this, we have come to the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about the follow-ups, why follow-up is an important part of journalism, and we also discussed about the Boston Globe case study. Now let us move on to the next discussion. Now look at this article. This article is regarding Malabar Rebellion. See, Malabar Rebellion is also known as Mopla Rebellion. Why this rebellion is in the news? See, the year 2021 marks 100 years of Malabar Rebellion. This is why this rebellion is in the news. So it is an important topic for preliminary exam. So pay attention. This discussion can be beneficial for 2021 prelims. Now let us discuss about Malabar Rebellion. See, as I already said, August 20 of 2021 marks the centenary of the Malabar Rebellion. Malabar Rebellion is also called as Mopla Riots. See, Malabar Rebellion had been an uprising of Muslim tenants against British rulers and local Hindu landlords. So these were the stakeholders of this revolt. The tenants were the Muslims, they were ruled by the British rulers, and it was against the local Hindu landlords. This uprising began on August 20th, 1921. This rebellion went on for several months. The most important point is this rebellion was a violent one. It had a lot of blood-stained events. See, when it comes to prelims, you can expect these kind of statements. Mopla Rebellion was a violent event. Which of the above statements are correct? So these kind of analytical questions can be asked in prelims. So make sure you remember this. Mopla Rebellion or Malabar Rebellion was a violent event. According to some historical experts, almost 10,000 lives were lost during this rebellion. So we can observe it as a violent movement. See, it is important to note that many historians see Malabar Rebellion as first nationalist uprising in southern India. Even the Kerala government in 1971 included the participants of the rebellion in the category of freedom fighters. Now we have a question. Where did this rebellion take place? See, this uprising took place in regions which are currently under the Malappuram district in North Kerala. The keyword, Malappuram district in North Kerala. Okay. What were the causes behind this revolt? First, let us see about the local cause. See, locally, the peasants were not happy with the landlords and the British policies on revenue. The peasants of Malabar were paying high taxes. So they were not happy with the landlords and the British policies. This was the first major local cause. Now moving on to the national level cause. See, 1921 was the time of Khilafat movement. So the national fervor and patriotism were running high. Also in 1920, Gandhiji had also visited the Malabar and had spoken about the Khilafat cause. So the unhappy peasants were inspired by the Khilafat movement. They were fascinated by the Gandhiji speech. So this is the national cause, Khilafat movement and Gandhiji visit. See, when we are talking about Malabar Rebellion, historians view it from different perspectives. Some historians view Malabar Rebellion as an agrarian revolt. That is, disgruntled peasants revolting against landlords. Whereas few historians view it from a religious angle. Muslims revolting against Hindus. So, they are viewing it from different perspectives. But for preliminary exam, let us view it as an agrarian revolt. Peasants standing up against landlords and British authority. Let us not get sucked into the controversy. Let us play it safe. Now, let us discuss the most important point of Moplah Rebellion. Whether Gandhiji supported Malabar Rebellion. See, initially Gandhi supported this revolt because initially it was a non-violent movement and Gandhiji supported the revolt. But later, this rebellion turned into a violent one. As I already said, almost 10,000 lives were lost during this revolt. So Congress and Gandhiji distanced themselves when the rebellion turned bloody and violent. This is an important point regarding Malabar Rebellion. See, these kind of statements will be given in prelims. That is why I am stressing it. See, Malabar Rebellion is a very important topic. It has stirred up controversy recently. It is also celebrating its 100th anniversary. So make sure you know the basic information regarding this revolt. So with this, we have come to the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about the Malabar Rebellion, the violent nature of Malabar Rebellion, the causes behind the Malabar Rebellion, the local cause, the national level cause, and finally, we saw the different perspectives of Malabar Rebellion, whether it is an agrarian movement or a religious movement. And the most important point is Gandhiji initially supported the revolt, but later he distanced himself. Now let us move on to the next discussion. Practice prelims question. First question. Malimath committee recently seen in news related to which of the following? A. Police reforms. B. Digital payments. C. Cryptocurrency. D. None of the above. See, the correct answer is A. Police reforms. Malimath committee is regarding police reforms. Now let us move on to the next question. Second question. With reference to Moplah Rebellion, consider the following statements. First statement. Moplah Rebellion happened in parts of Assam in the second decade of 20th century. Second statement. It is a bloodless revolt that took place peacefully. Which of the statements given above are correct? A. 1 only. B. 2 only. C. Both 1 and 2. D. Neither 1 nor 2. See, both the statements are incorrect. Moplah Rebellion happened in Malappuram district of Kerala and it also happened in 1920. So, early decade of 20th century. So, first statement is incorrect. Moving on to the second statement. See, Moplah Rebellion or Malabar Rebellion was a violent event. Almost 10,000 lives were lost during this revolt. But the second statement says it is a bloodless revolt that took place peacefully. So, this statement is also incorrect. So, the answer is D. Neither one nor two. Both the statements are incorrect. Mains practice questions are displayed here. You can write your answer and post in the comment section below. With this, we have come to the end of the news analysis. If you like the video, click like, comment and subscribe. Thank you.